Reading from Srimad-Bhagavatam, Canto 1, Chapter 13. Chapter 13 is entitled Vibhrashtra Quit Home. Text number 15. Abhibhrat Aryama Dandam Yathavad Aghakarishu Yavad Dadhar Sudratvam Shapad Varsha Shatam Yamaha.
Translation. As long as Vidura played the part of a Shudra, being cursed by Manduka Muni, Aryama officiated at the post of Yamaraj to punish those who committed sinful acts. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Vidura, born in the womb of a Shudra woman, was forbidden even to be a party of royal heritage along with his brothers, Dhritarashtra and Pandu. Then how could he occupy the post of a preacher to instruct such learned kings and kshatriyas as Dhritarashtra and Maharaj Yudhishthira? The first answer is that, even though it is accepted that he was a Shudra by birth, because he renounced the world for spiritual enlightenment by the authority of Rishi Maitreya and was thoroughly educated by him in transcendental knowledge, he was quite competent to occupy the post of an acharya or spiritual preceptor. According to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, anyone who is conversant in the transcendental knowledge or the science of Godhead, be he a Brahmana or a Shudra, a householder or a sannyasi, is eligible to become a spiritual master. Even in the ordinary moral codes maintained by Chanakya Pandit, the great politician and moralist, there is no harm in taking lessons from a person who may be by birth less than a Shudra. This is one part of the answer. The other is that Vidura was not actually a Shudra. He was to play the part of a so-called Shudra for 100 years, being cursed by Manduka Muni. He was the incarnation of Yamaraj, one of the 12 Mahajanas, on the level with such exalted personalities as Brahma, Narada, Shiva, Kapila, Bhishma, Prahlada, etc. Being a Mahajana, it is the duty of Yamaraj to preach the cult of devotion to the people of the world, as Narada, Brahma and other Mahajanas do. But Yamaraj is always busy in his platonic kingdom punishing the doers of sinful acts. Yamaraj is deputed by the Lord to a particular planet some hundreds of thousands of miles away from the planet of Earth to take away the corrupt souls after death and convict them in accordance with their respective sinful activities. Thus, Yamaraj has very little time to take leave from his responsible office of punishing the wrongdoers. There are more wrongdoers than righteous men. Therefore, Yamaraj has to do more work than other demigods who are also authorized agents of the Supreme Lord. But he wanted to preach the glories of the Lord, and therefore by the will of the Lord he was cursed by Manduka Muni to come into the world in the incarnation of Vidura and work very hard as a great devotee. Such a devotee is neither a Shudra nor a Brahmana. He is transcendental to such divisions of mundane society, just as the personality of Godhead assumes his incarnation as a hog, but he is neither a hog nor a Brahma. He is above all mundane creatures. The Lord and his different authorized devotees sometimes have to play the role of many lower creatures to claim the conditioned souls, but both the Lord and his pure devotees are always in the transcendental position. When Yamaraj thus incarnated himself as Vidura, his post was officiated by Aryama, one of the many sons of Kashyapa and Aditi. The Adityas are sons of Aditi, and there are 12 Adityas. Aryama is one of the 12 Adityas, and therefore it was quite possible for him to take charge of the office of Yamaraj during his 100 years absence in the form of Vidura. The conclusion is that Vidura was never a Shudra, but was greater than the purest type of Brahmana. So this verse is a very interesting verse that it actually is clarifying how in the Krishna consciousness movement the importance is given not for the birth in a particular family, but rather the qualification of a person, especially of devotees, irrespective of which family they might have taken birth. The example that is given here is that of Yamaraj playing the part of a Shudra as Vidura. It is said here, as long as Vidura played the part of a Shudra, being cursed by Manduka Muni, Aryama officiated at the post of Yamaraj to punish those who committed sinful acts. So the history of Vidura is explained in an earlier verse, that Vidura actually is an incarnation of Yamaraj. He was cursed by one Manduka Muni due to apparently some mistake that was done by Yamaraj. So the result of that curse was that Yamaraj had to take birth as the son of a Shudra. So he was born as the son of a maidservant in the royal palace of Hastinapura. So he was born as the younger brother of Dhritarashtra and Pandu. But even though he was born as the younger brother of Dhritarashtra and Pandu, his position was not exactly like that of Dhritarashtra and Pandu. Dhritarashtra and Pandu, they were born as the sons of the emperor Vichitravirya. So they were considered as having taken birth as Kshatriyas. Whereas Vidura was born as the son of a maidservant in that palace. So Vidura is not considered a Kshatriya. He is considered a Shudra because he was born of a Shudra woman. So according to the laws of inheritance, it is described by Srila Prabhupada in this purport, Vidura born in the womb of a Shudra woman was forbidden even to be a party of royal heritage along with his brothers Dhritarashtra and Pandu. So Vidura could not get any inheritance as a person who had taken birth in the palace, because he was considered the son of a maidservant. So he did not get any inheritance. So the question may be raised that how could he occupy the post of a preacher to instruct such learned kings and kshatriyas as Dhritarashtra and Maharaj Yudhishthira? So there are three parts to this question being answered by Srila Prabhupada in the purport. The first part of the answer is that, or the first answer for this question is that, even though it is accepted that he was a Shudra by birth, he renounced the world for spiritual enlightenment. Vidura took advantage of some apparent misunderstanding with Duryodhana. Before he left the palace, Vidura was always acting as the well-wisher of his elder brother Dhritarashtra and was giving him very valuable advice. Dhritarashtra was the caretaker king. Because of Pandu's untimely death, Pandu was the emperor, and when Pandu died, his eldest son Yudhishthira should have become the emperor. But because Yudhishthira was still a minor, it was decided that till Yudhishthira comes of age, Dhritarashtra will be the caretaker king. So while Dhritarashtra was acting as the caretaker king, Vidura was giving very valuable advice to Dhritarashtra. So Vidura was actually very intelligent and quite competent to advise Dhritarashtra, because he is the incarnation of Yamaraj. So Yamaraj is not an ordinary person. Yamaraj is actually one of the greatest devotees of the Supreme Lord. So being an incarnation of Yamaraj, Vidura was quite competent to advise Dhritarashtra. And Dhritarashtra knew this, that Vidura is very intelligent and is able to give good advice. But once when Vidura advised Dhritarashtra not to follow the policy adopted by Duryodhana, that time Duryodhana became very angry against Vidura. He insulted Vidura by calling him the son of a maidservant, even though it's a fact that Vidura was the son of a maidservant. The way Duryodhana actually spoke, it was quite insulting for Vidura. So Vidura apparently was insulted by Duryodhana. But Vidura did not actually feel hurt by the insult hurled by Duryodhana. He was just looking for an opportunity to get out of that palace in order to seek spiritual enlightenment from an enlightened soul. So therefore, making an excuse as if he was insulted, he left the palace and he went away. Apparently, he went on a pilgrimage. Actually, even pilgrimage was not the real reason why Vidura left the palace. He wanted to actually meet a self-realized soul and seek enlightenment from a self-realized soul. So therefore, on the plea of going on a pilgrimage, he traveled to different holy places and he was searching out for a self-realized person from whom he wanted to get transcendental knowledge. So he went on traveling till he met Maitreya Rishi. And as soon as he met Maitreya Rishi, he requested Maitreya Rishi to enlighten him in spiritual subject matter. And when Maitreya Rishi agreed to enlighten Vidura by giving him transcendental knowledge, that is when Vidura actually stayed with Maitreya Rishi in Badrikashrama and actually inquired from him on so many different questions, asking him many different important questions. They are all recorded as the conversation between Vidura and Maitreya in the Srimad-Bhagavatam itself. So when he became thoroughly educated by Maitreya Rishi, and he was completely convinced that the ultimate goal of life is to get shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna, he stopped asking any further questions, and then he decided to visit his brother Dhritarashtra and enlighten Dhritarashtra or give him proper advice and guidance so that Dhritarashtra will not simply waste time enjoying some facilities in the palace. So therefore he decided to return to the palace in Hastinapura in order to benefit his younger, his elder brother, Dhritarashtra. So, the position of Vidura is, even though he was by birth a Shudra, because he was thoroughly educated in transcendental knowledge by Maitreya Rishi, and he was spiritually enlightened, so he was very competent to occupy the post of an Acharya or spiritual preceptor. This is what is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Yasya yallakshanam proktam pumso varnabhi vyanjakam yad anyatra api drishyeta tattenaiva vinirdishet. This is a verse spoken by Narad Muni. Narad Muni, while describing the different varnas and the different qualifications and the duties of people situated in different varnas, he specifically says that even though somebody might be born in a particular varna as a son of a Brahmana or a Kshatriya or whatever, he says, if one shows the symptoms of being a Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya or Shudra, as described above, means described earlier, even if he has appeared in a different class, that means he has taken birth in a different varna, as a son of, let's say somebody is born as the son of a Shudra, but he is showing the symptoms of a Brahmana, he should be accepted according to those symptoms of classification and not according to the classification of birth. So this is very important, that if, let's say Vidura, so an example let us take, he is born as the son of a Shudra, but being enlightened by Maitreya Rishi, he is having all the qualifications for instructing others in spiritual knowledge, for playing the part of a Brahmana, then he should be accepted as a Brahmana and not as a Shudra. Even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he says, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, anyone who is conversant in the transcendental knowledge or the science of Godhead, be he a Brahmana or a Shudra, a householder or a sannyasi, is eligible to become a spiritual master. So the verse which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually speaks in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is given. Kiba vipra kiba nyasi shudra kena noy, yei Krishna tattva veta sei guru hoy. It says that whether one is a brahmana, a sannyasi or a shudra, regardless of what he is, he can be a spiritual master if he knows the science of Krishna. So the importance Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave was for somebody being thoroughly conversant with the science of Krishna consciousness. That is more important than the social position or even the position as being born in a particular varna or being situated in a particular ashrama. So according to the varnashrama system, there are four social classifications, Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, and they have different designated duties. So a Brahmana generally in the varnashrama society, he acts as the teacher of all other people in all other varnas. And even among the brahmanas, because a brahmana may be situated in four different ashramas, as a brahmachari, as a grihastha, as a vanaprastha or a sannyasi. So even among brahmanas, a sannyasi is considered to be the spiritual master of all the others in other varnas and other ashramas. So this is the conventional varnashrama classification. But this particular conventional classification does not hold when there is a person who is thoroughly conversant with the science of Krishna consciousness. So according to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, if somebody is expert in the science of Krishna consciousness, then regardless of his position in the varnashrama society, whether he is a brahmana or a shudra, it doesn't matter, or he is situated as a householder or a sannyasi, a grihastha or a sannyasi, it doesn't matter. In any case, whatever be his varna or ashrama position, he is fit to become a spiritual master simply because he is thoroughly conversant with the science of Krishna consciousness. So that is the real qualification. One should be thoroughly conversant with the science of Krishna consciousness in order to become a spiritual master. That is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teaching. Then further, Prabhupada says, even in the ordinary moral codes maintained by Chanakya Pandit. Chanakya Pandit was a great politician and also a great moralist. He has compiled a book called Niti Shastra, Ordinary Moral Codes. So he says, Chanakya Pandit says, Vishadapi amritam grahyam amedhyadapi kanchanam neechadapi uttamam jnanam stri ratnam dushkuladapi. Chanakya Pandit says that one would accept nectar even from poison and gold even from a filthy place. One should accept knowledge even from a low-born person and a good wife even if she comes from a low family. Four things he says. Particularly, Prabhupada is quoting or pointing out Chanakya Pandit's Niti Shastra, telling that one should accept knowledge even from a low-born person. So birth is not important. It is the real position of a person being enlightened because of having being been trained up by an expert guru or a teacher. If somebody is in such a position as having become enlightened because of good training, then one should accept knowledge from such an enlightened person, even though he may be by birth a low-born person. So that also applies in the case of Vidura, that even though by birth he was a Shudra, he was enlightened by receiving transcendental knowledge from the greatest authority, Maitreya Rishi. Maitreya Rishi was personally instructed by Krishna. Krishna, before he disappeared, he actually instructed Uddhava and Maitreya Rishi. So Maitreya Rishi was exceptionally qualified, and Vidura received transcendental knowledge from Maitreya Rishi. So having been educated by Maitreya Rishi, Vidura was exceptionally qualified also. Therefore, even though he was born in a Shudra family, he was quite competent to instruct such exalted personalities as Yudhishthira and even Dhritarashtra. Then the other part of the answer, or the second answer, is that Vidura was not actually a Shudra. He was to play the part of a so-called Shudra for 100 years because of a curse by Manduka Muni. Actually, Yamaraj, in his position as a very exalted devotee, he could have reversed the curse of Manduka Muni. But being a great devotee, such devotees take a very humble position and they don't try to reverse a curse uttered by either a great sage or a great brahmana. They humbly accept such a curse, and simply depending upon the Lord, they undergo whatever is the curse, whatever may be the curse. So even though Yamaraj could have actually reversed that curse, he didn't do so. Another example that is given in the Bhagavatam itself is that Parikshit Maharaj, he was cursed by this young son of a very powerful sage, by one Sringi, son of Shamika Rishi. Even though Shamika Rishi admitted that his son should not have cursed the emperor Parikshit, still Parikshit, even though he came to know of the curse and he could have reversed the curse, but he did not do so. He accepted the curse that he was to die within 7 days by a snake bite. So like Parikshit Maharaj, even Yamaraj, he accepted the curse to take birth as the son of a Shudra and undergo life as a Shudra, as play the part of a Shudra, so-called Shudra. So as incarnation of Yamaraj, he is actually, Yamaraj is one of the 12 Mahajanas. Who are Mahajanas? Mahajanas are the most exalted personalities in this entire universe, who are actually knowers of the real principles of Dharma. In the Srimad-Bhagavatam, it is explained, there are 12 Mahajanas in this universe. Who are they? Swayambhu, Narada Shambhu, Kumar Kapilo Manuhu, Prahlado Janako Bhishmo, Balir Vyasaki Vayam. This is a word spoken by Yamaraj himself when he is instructing the Yamadutas about the glories of the holy name. That time, Yamaraj is mentioning there are 12 Mahajanas in this universe. They are Brahma, Narada, Lord Shiva, the four Kumaras, Kapila, Manu, Pralada, Janaka, Bhishma, Bali Maharaj, Shukadeva Goswami, and Yamaraj himself. He says, Yamaraj says, Dvadashaite Vijanimo Dharma Bhagavatam Bhataha. What is called Bhagavata Dharma is perfectly known to these 12 Mahajanas. Guhyam Vishuddham Durbodham Yam Jnatva Amrutam Ashnute. So Yamaraj is telling that because these Mahajanas are great devotees, they are fully conversant with this principles of Bhagavata Dharma. This is real Dharma. What is real Dharma? Bhagavata Dharma. So, the very confidential and difficult principles of Dharma are not easy to be understood by ordinary human beings. But if one is fortunate to receive the confidential understanding of the principles of Dharma from a Mahajana, from a great devotee, from these 12 devotees or from their representatives, other devotees who are representatives of these 12 Mahajanas, then such a fortunate person is able to properly understand the principles of Dharma, and by following the confidential principles of Dharma as enunciated in Bhagavatam, which is called Bhagavata Dharma, such a person immediately becomes liberated and returns home back to Godhead. So, the principles of Dharma are not easy to understand by everyone. Neither by simply studying some Dharma Shastras one can understand the principles of Dharma. There are actually 20 important Dharma Shastras. They are compiled by great sages like Manu. You might have heard Manu Smriti or Manu Samhita or Yajnavalkya Smriti, Parashara Smriti. Like this, there are the principles of Dharma explained in 20 different scriptures. But still, many times the principles seem to be contradictory. Prabhupada gives a nice example. He says, in the scriptures it is mentioned that stool is untouchable. And if anybody by chance touches stool, they have to immediately take a bath to become purified. But the exception is the cow dung. Now, cow dung, from ordinary vision, is also the stool of the cow. But cow dung is not at all contaminating. On the other hand, cow dung is purifying. In fact, when we perform Abhishek of Lord Krishna, we bathe Krishna with cow urine and cow dung. So cow dung is especially pure, and it also can purify any contaminated object. So cow dung is the exception that is specially mentioned in the Shastras. Now somebody may say, when Shastras are proclaiming all types of stool, stool is untouchable, how do you say that cow dung is purified? So the Dharma Shastras have to be explained by an authority. For that matter, any Vedic injunction, we cannot exactly understand how to follow without consulting an authority on the Vedas. Therefore, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattvadarshinaha. Krishna is describing in the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita that there are different types of sacrifices mentioned in the Vedas. and one should perform work as sacrifice with reference to the sacrifices described in the Vedas. Though sacrifice means pleasing Vishnu by one's work, one cannot adopt any type of work or cannot do any whimsically, cannot do anything and simply make a show of offering that result of that work to the Supreme Lord Vishnu and thereby consider that he has done sacrifice. No. So Krishna particularly mentions that sacrifice should be that which is enumerated in the Vedas. Now, even if one is referring the Vedas and trying to do some work as sacrifice with reference to the Vedas, the injunctions in the Vedas are not easy to follow. There are so many rules and regulations mentioned in the Vedas. Therefore, Krishna says, even though the Vedic scriptures are describing different types of sacrifices for different kinds of people who have different inclinations to work, still, to know which type of sacrifice I should perform, I should actually approach a bona fide spiritual master and under his guidance perform a particular type of sacrifice in order to please Vishnu. You see? So, approaching a bona fide spiritual master for understanding the Vedic injunctions is absolutely essential. Such a spiritual master, the scriptures say, must be a Vaishnava. It's not enough if a person is a learned and qualified Brahmana, according to the conventional understanding of who is a qualified Brahmana. The scriptures say, Shat karma nipuno vipro mantra tantra visharadaha. Avaishnavo guru nasyat Vaishnava shvapacho guru. Even though one may be a well-qualified Brahmana, expert in mantra tantra visharadaha, expert in chanting all the mantras and in following all the procedures of the Vedic injunctions, still, if he is not a Vaishnava, he is not a devotee of Krishna, such a person is not qualified to become a spiritual master. On the other hand, if there is a person who has taken birth in the family of Chandalas, Chandala is lower than a Shudra, and according to Vedic Varnashrama classification. So, even if one is born as a Chandala, still, if he is a Vaishnava, because he is fortunate to actually come in contact with a qualified Vaishnava and under his guidance also accept the principles of devotion and service, and by practicing under the proper guidance, the principles of bhakti, one becomes himself a devotee, even though having taken birth in the family of even Chandala, doesn't matter. If he is trained up as a devotee, then he is qualified to become a spiritual master. So, like that, Vidura, even though he was born as a Shudra, still, because he was trained up by Maitreya Rishi, he was quite competent to become a spiritual master. Further, Prabhupada also explains that as a Mahajana, it is the duty of Yamaraj to preach the cult of devotion to the people of the world, just like the other Mahajanas do. Narada is the best example. What is Narada doing? Narada is just traveling all over the universe and he keeps on preaching about bhakti. In fact, it is very difficult to find interested people in this world. So Narada keeps traveling, searching for somebody who might be interested in hearing about bhakti or learning about bhakti. Because common people, including those in the heavenly planets, they are busy with trying to enjoy materially. Birth in the material world means generally people are interested in material enjoyment. So most people in this material world are interested only in material enjoyment. They are not interested in self-realization. But it is especially mentioned that the human form of life is meant for self-realization. So in spite of people who take birth as human beings having the facility for pursuing self-realization, still most people are not interested in self-realization, including the demigods. The demigods are supposed to be highly cultured. They are very, very pious. But still, in their position as devatas, many devatas, they are not interested in self-realization. So that being the case, Narad Muni finds it very, very difficult to instruct somebody in the matter of devotional service or self-realization. Therefore, he keeps traveling and searching. Where is somebody who is interested? So in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is a description. Once Narad Muni came across a hunter, and he took compassion upon this hunter who was very, very sinful. His name was Mrigari. This hunter, he was expert in killing animals in such a way that the animal will not die when he shoots an arrow, a poisonous arrow. He will half kill an animal and he'll take pleasure in seeing the animal suffer due to the pain. He was so cruel, this hunter. Hunters are cruel because they don't have any compassion when it comes to killing animals when they hunt. But this hunter would not simply kill an animal. He would give it pain and he would take pleasure in seeing the animal suffering in pain because the animal would not immediately die. So Narad Muni saw this hunter killing animals, half killing animals and giving them so much pain. So he approached the hunter and tried to actually talk to him that why are you doing this kind of killing? So the hunter said, you see, actually I have been taught like this by my father. How to half kill animals. And I take pleasure in seeing the animals suffer in that way. So Narad Muni said, this is very, very, very sinful. You're going to suffer for this in future. You're going to suffer a lot in the future. So the words coming out of Narad Muni's lips, it had some solid effect on this hunter. The hunter became very much afraid to even think about the suffering he is going to undergo in the future. So immediately he became very worried and he immediately surrendered to Narad Muni and said, is there any way that I can actually come out of this situation? So then Narad Muni took compassion upon this hunter and instructed him to simply chant the holy name of the Supreme Lord. And this hunter followed Narad Muni's instruction and became a great devotee. Simply by stopping this sinful activity of killing animals and chanting the holy name, he became a great devotee. So, like this it is said, Narada Muni is searching, where is some a person whom I can preach to. So, Narada Muni is always engaged in traveling and preaching. But Yamaraj, you see, Yamaraj's position, he is a Mahajana. Definitely, he would like to preach. But Yamaraj's position is, or duty is, that he is meant to punish the sinful people. So he is always busy in his plutonic kingdom punishing the doers of sinful activities. Even though Yamaraj is a great devotee, still he is deputed by the Supreme Lord to some particular planet, Yamaloka, which is hundreds of thousands of miles away from the planet Earth. And it is in that planet that Yamaraj, he arranges to bring the most sinful people after their death to convict them according to their respective sinful activities. Among the sinful activities a human being can perform, there are two categories of sinful activities. One is those sinful activities which are not very, very grievous type of sins. Some minor violation of Vedic injunctions. Such sinful activities, one doesn't have to get punished by Yamaraj after death, immediately after death. Such sinful actions, one will receive punishment in the course of their future births. But if somebody is extremely sinful, just like somebody is involved in killing, let's say, cows, innocent animals, then such a person, after his death, he is taken by Yamadutas to Yamaraj. And Yamaraj, according to the degree of sinful activity, he orders punishment for such a sinful person. So Yamaraj has very little time to leave from his responsible office of punishing the wrongdoers and actually engaging in preaching. And Prabhupada says there are more wrongdoers than righteous men. Definitely in the material world there are too many wrongdoers. Therefore Yamaraj has to do more work than other demigods. Demigods are all authorized agents of the Supreme Lord for universal administration. But Yamaraj's duty is to punish the wrongdoers, and there are too many wrongdoers, so he doesn't get much of a break from his duties. And it is said by Prabhupada here that Yamaraj wanted to actually preach the glories of the Lord. Therefore, by the will of the Supreme Lord, he was cursed by this Manduka Muni. And that way, he got a break from his duty of punishing the wrongdoers. And therefore, it is said, what happens? That post becomes vacant for 100 years. No, it is not vacant. It was officiated by another qualified person, one of the Adityas by name Aryama. Aryama was officiating in the place of Yamaraj, as long as Yamaraj was playing the part of Vishudra as Vidura. So the post was not vacant. The post was taken care of. But Yamaraj got a break. And as Vidura, he was always actually engaged in preaching. So before he left the palace and went to get enlightenment from Maitreya Rishi, he was advising his elder brother Dhritarashtra and giving him advice, even though it was of the nature of giving him instructions or advice in administration. Actually, Vidura was always acting as a devotee giving devotional instructions. So therefore, Vidura was always doing his work as a devotee preaching Krishna consciousness. As Vidura, he was always preaching Krishna consciousness. And therefore, it is said here that the Lord and his different devotees sometimes have to play the role of many lower creatures to claim the conditioned souls. Sometimes the Supreme Lord assumes forms which are like lower life forms. Just like the Supreme Lord incarnates as a fish or a tortoise or a hog. So when the Supreme Lord incarnates in these forms, his position as the Supreme Lord, Transcendental Personality, is unchanged. So he is not actually acting as a hog or acting as a fish, but rather he is acting as the Supreme Lord in order to reclaim the conditioned souls from this material world. So just like when he incarnated as the Varaha incarnation, the hog incarnation, he actually appeared to deliver the demon Hiranyaksha. He appeared for delivering Hiranyaksha. And he also rescued the earth planet by actually lifting the earth from the Rasatala region. Hiranyaksha had actually thrown the earth planet into the Rasatala region. So the Supreme Lord appeared as Varaha and lifted the earth out of the Rasatala region. And also this Hiranyaksha, who was creating a lot of trouble for the people in general, so he killed Hiranyaksha. But the Lord's killing is not ordinary. When the Supreme Lord kills somebody, actually he liberates them. So Hiranyaksha was liberated by the Supreme Lord in his incarnation as Varaha. So this extraordinary activities definitely establish the Supreme Lord as not having degraded himself by assuming a form of a boar or a fish or whatever. Similarly, the pure devotees, when they come to this world, even though they may assume a inferior position, a lower position, like Yamaraj assumed the position of a Shudra, but his activities are completely like those of a pure devotee. We can see how he is instructing Dhritarashtra exactly as a devotee is instructing Dhritarashtra. And they always act as a devotee. They don't act like a lower creature or a Shudra. No. They act as a devotee. They perform activities as a devotee. And therefore it is said by Prabhupada here that both the Lord and his pure devotees are always in the transcendental position. Their activities, their consciousness is always transcendental. It is never like that of the lower creature or the lower birth that they assume. No, it's never like that. So the conclusion is that Vidura was never a Shudra, but was greater than the purest type of Brahmana. So devotees are always greater than even the Brahmanas. Pure devotees are always greater than even the purest Brahmana. So Vidura was always acting and also situated in the position of a pure devotee, even though he had taken birth as a Shudra. He's never to be considered as a Shudra. He's not even to be considered as a Brahmana. He's greater than a Brahmana also. He's actually a pure devotee, completely transcendentally situated. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any updates.